This is a TV Cogeco special presentation.
On February 9, 1936, in St. John, New Brunswick, Thomas Charles Connors was welcomed into the world. Tom was separated from his mother at a young age and raised by foster parents in Skinner's Pond, PEI, until he was 13 years old. His life of poverty, orphanages, hitchhiking, and playing bars would eventually turn into a life of hit songs, national concert tours, and fame in spite of a constant uphill battle to be recognized by the music industry in Canada. Tom's unwavering love for promoting his home country led to some of the many accolades he received, including becoming an officer of the Order of Canada, being immortalized on a Canadian postage stamp, and being invited to receive the Governor General's Performing Arts Award, to name but a few. On March 6th, Canada lost one of its true musical icons. Stompin Tom passed away at his home in Ontario, with his family seeing him off, leaving one final message to everyone.
Thank you. Well, very good evening, ladies and gentlemen. My name is Brian Edwards, and for 24 years, thank you. For 24 years, I had the pleasure of being Stompin Tom's promoter all across North America. And on behalf of the citizens of Peterborough, I'm so thrilled to just be here tonight and be able to have this wonderful celebration of life for Stompin Tom. First of all, this Peterborough Pop Ensemble that did Our Canada, weren't they great? You want to believe it. When I sat with Tom a few weeks ago, he says, Brian, do your best and you don't have to be perfect. So now I'm really relaxed. And they kicked the party off in true Stompin' Tom fashion, all the way from Spud Island, Billy McGinnis and the Stompin' Tom Band. Let her go, boys. Thank you. Wasn't that something else? And that was by special request. And guess who wanted that? There you go. What a wonderful way to start the evening. And there's nobody that would have wanted it better than Stompin Tom. Well, we're going to do everything tonight that's going to pay tribute to him. And by cracky, when we get this two-hour show underway, we're going to really show you how we can throw a party, right? Yeah, you betcha. Before we go too much further, Tom always made it a tradition when he was finished his first song that we introduce all the fellas in the band. And this fella stealing the steel guitar over here was with Tom way back in the horseshoe days and did all that great music with Tom on his recordings like Bud the Spud. Mickey Anders from Cape Breton, Prince Ed. Go, Mickey. Standing beside him is a fellow that's played the guitar and the steel on many tours with him, Mr. Al Widmeyer. And next, Al is a fellow that opened a lot of the tours for us as the front man and also played in Tom's band, Mark LaForme. And right up the road here from Plainsfield, Ontario, Mr. Tim Hadley. Another fellow that Tom really liked that opened up a tours for him, and he writes a lot of great fine Canadian songs, and Tom always enjoyed having him on the road with us. All the way from the Kootenays in BC, ladies and gentlemen, please welcome Tim Huss. And this fine gentleman that put this fiddle medley together, all the way from Prince Edward Island, Mr. Billy McGinnis. And I know we've got a lot of Spud Islanders right here in the audience tonight, right? You ought to believe it. Well, some 3 weeks ago, I had to sit down with a gentleman and share some very confidential information with him. And I asked him that he keep everything very confidential. And he and his staff at City Hall of Peterborough have been absolutely tremendous. And I can't tell you how warm it's been and a welcome that we've had, and the fact that it was confidential really meant a lot to us. And I'm going to get him to come up here and bring greetings on behalf of the city. Your Worship, Mayor Daryl Bennett, come on up here.
How about a word, wow? Wouldn't Tom be proud of this crowd tonight? Great for me to bring greetings from the city of Peterborough and to make recognition of this very significant occasion. The flag at City Hall remains at half mast as a symbol of a community in mourning. We gather tonight in recognition of a great Canadian. We come together not only to celebrate the life of Stompin Tom Connors, but to share in a celebration of his marvelous passion for both his country and its people. It is important that we do so in Peterborough. For while Tom touched all Canadians, perhaps like any Canadian before him, it was his wish to be remembered in this city and in this manner. It was in our city on Canada Day, on Canada's centennial in 1967, the day we celebrated the 100th anniversary of Canadian Confederation, that a waiter at the King George Tavern on Simcoe Street by the name of Boyd MacDonald first added the nickname Stompin to the name Tom Connors. By then, the image of Tom stomping his heavy black cowboy boot with prejudice onto a defenseless piece of innocent plywood set on the stage floor was well known. But in Peterborough, it truly gained official status. Tom liked the name so much that he officially registered the name Stompin Tom Limited the following week. Our city is the inspiration for Tom's song called The Peterborough Postman, a story about a man's longing for the postman from Peterborough to deliver him a letter for his lost and lamented woman. And it has to be noted that the city of Peterborough, led by then Mayor Jack Doris, had the very good judgment in October of 1993 to present Stompin Tom with one of the highest awards that we can, namely the key to the city of Peterborough. As he opened so many doors for us, we were honored to provide him with the key to ours. Tom's challenges as a very young man were many, and more difficult than many will know. Those challenges made his accomplishments all the more impressive and inspiring. He wrote hundreds of songs. He released 51 albums and sold millions of copies around the world. He is an officer of the Order of Canada. He was awarded an honorary Doctor of Laws from the St. Thomas University in Fredericton. He is the winner of 2 East Coast Music Awards. He is the winner of 6 Juno Awards, all of which he returned in protest against the lack of support for Canadian artists. He has produced an autobiography, several children's books, a movie, and a television series. And he has done it all without ever leaving his beloved Canada. I want to share my favorite Tom Connors story with you. Lieutenant General Romeo Dallaire was the force commander of the United Nations Assistance Mission for Rwanda in 1994. He led the UN peacekeeping force that was attempting to stop the terrible genocide that was taking place in that country. In his book, Shake Hands with the Devil, The Failure of Humanity in Rwanda, General Dallaire wrote that in the most trying times of war, while the UN headquarters was being bombarded, he chose to lift the spirits of his troops by playing the recording of Stompin Tom's song, The Blue Berets. It is, in my view, the highest honor that an artist can receive, knowing that your art is being used to help cope with the presence of death and the sanctity of life. Those who we have loved and lost are no longer where they used to be. They are now forever with us, in our hearts, and in our thoughts. Stompin Tom was many things, but he was first and foremost a Canadian storyteller, a man who proudly wore the maple leaf on his heart for all the world to see. And we are grateful that he did that. You will recall that I mentioned the Peterborough Postman. Please enjoy listening to it now, and thank you all for being here.
Thank you. I'd like to send this next song out to a lot of the folks around Peterborough, Ontario, one of my old stomping grounds. And also, because this is about a postman as well, I'd like to dedicate it to all those folks with the Canadian Post Office. I see the programs on TV are getting better, and the music on the radio is fine. got lots of records too that I play and think of you, but that don't keep the worry from my mind. When the Peterboro postman passes by, I cry, and I wonder why we ever said goodbye. For I'm always home alone, but you don't even phone, and the Peterboro postman passes by. Sometimes I want to leave this town forever, but my heart won't let me go till you return. And when all the house is still, I sit beside my windowsill, waiting, watching, worried while I yearn. When the Peterboro postman passes by, I cry, and I wonder why we ever said goodbye. For I'm always home alone, but you don't even phone, and the Peterboro...
Cut to him next. He's a fellow I mentioned a little earlier that came in from the Kootenays, and Tom loved having him on the road with us and singing great Canadian story songs, and he wrote a wonderful song about Tom that we know you're going to really like. Ladies and gentlemen, Mr. Tim Huss.
Hello, friends. It was one of the great thrills and honors of my life when I received a personal invitation from Stompin Tom to go on the road with him and open his concerts. And I was the last guy to make the cross-country trek with him, playing concerts from Newfoundland to Vancouver. And when I was a kid and I was just learning to play guitar, I wrote a song about my favorite country singer. And years later, it was the song that I used to bring him out on stage every night. So I'd like to sing it for you this evening. This is my own composition called Man with the Black Hat. Here's a song about a man I think you all know. He plays a Canadian country music show. A man of the land from east to west. He wears a red maple leaf pinned to his vest. From PEI, where the potatoes grow, to the tobacco fields of Ontario. Saturday night in Sudbury Town, and how the bridge came tumbling down. With a sawdust line, oh my lord, he stomps his boot on the stomping board. He sings about Canada, he sings it like that. He always wears a big black cowboy hat. Born in St. John, New Brunswick, life was tough and he grew up quick. At 15, he hit the road for good, hitchhiking with his buddy Steve Foote. Down the highway with an old guitar, riding the freight train on a cattle car, singing songs of the people and the places found. He called them all my stomping grounds. With a sawdust line, oh my lord, he stomps his boot on a stomping board. He sings about Canada, he sings it like that. He always wears a big black cowboy hat. Thirteen years down the road, he blew into Timmins, Ontario. Busted and broke, not feeling too well. He got a job singing at the Maple Leaf Hotel. Soon his voice was on the radio, and he was playing the horseshoe down in Toronto. He became a star, one of a kind, through the mountains and the prairies and the Maritimes. With a sawdust line, oh my lord, he stomps his boot on a stomping board. He sings about Canada, he sings it like that. He always wears a big black cowboy hat. He told all the people in the songs he wrote, in the mines and the farms and the camps and the coal boats. Red River Jane and the Moon Man Newfie, Big Joe Muffera and Muck Tuck Annie. He stood up tall and he made a stand, and he said, I'm proud to be Canadian. So here's to Bud the Spud and the hockey song, and here's to you, Stompin' Tom. With a sawdust line, oh my lord, he stomps his boot on a stomping board. He sings about Canada, he sings it like that. He always wears a big black cowboy hat.
Tim Huss, ladies and gentlemen. Now you can see why Stompin' Tom likes him, right? You want to believe it. I'd be reminiscent whether I didn't mention the fact that last night in here there was an OHL hockey game. Everybody knows that? What you don't know is how many hours it took to get this building ready overnight, and the wonderful staff at this Peterborough Memorial Center made it all happen. And I tell you, that was something else. They worked all night long to get things going, and they certainly made everything work well. Tim, who we got coming up here next?
Well, I'd like to introduce a couple of friends, award-winning musicians from the East Coast of Canada. Both of them worked concert tours with Stompin' Tom. Please make welcome J.P. Cormier and Dave Gunning, everybody.
Wawa was a wild goose who from the Southland flew in a V-shaped flock of wild geese with her lover, Gander Goo. Her lover, Gander Goo. They flew across North Michigan to see the sights below, for they were on their honeymoon to North Ontario, to North Ontario. Honk, honk, said a little Wawa. Honk, honk, my Gander Goo. If you're stuck, that means I love you and always will be true. Always will be true. Little Wawa. Little Wawa. The night was fast approaching. A deadly hissing sound was an arrow from an Indian's bow, and Gander Goo shot down. Gander Goo fell down. The wild geese kept on flying, but Wawa would not go. She stayed to find her lover in the bushland far below. The bushland far below. Honk, honk, said little Wawa. Honk, honk, my Gander Goo. If you talk, that means I love you. Always will be true. Always will be true. Little Wawa. That died of heartbreak, a legend she became, but now she'll live forever in a town that bears her name, in a town that bears her name. So if you see her statue on Highway 17, you'll know that you're in Wawa, and her love song you will sing, her love song you will sing. Honk, said little Wawa, honk, honk, my Gander Goo. If you stop, that means I love you. Always will be true, always will be true. Little Wawa, little Wawa, little Wawa, Wawa. Thank you. My friend, Mr. Dave Gunning.
Such an incredible honor to be here tonight.
Every single way. Break a day to pull traps and old skin trousers. Yeah. on a Susie Jack. But tonight we're back with 1,000 pounds of lobsters. Oh, she's down, I'm gonna tear you down. I got me money coming out of me stockings. Hey, now I'm new, the bushwhack shoe. We'll take you to the gumbo club, and we'll do a little gumbo club, and we'll do a little gumbo club. We got fish and brew, a quahog stew, and a bowl of clam chowder. Just see you reach for that loopy squeak when they did it up the food too louder. Yeah, the French girls sing and the guitars ring, the squeak box squeakity squawking. Me and my suit gonna whoop-dee-doo, take her to the gumbo club, and we'll do a little gumbo club, and we'll do a little gumbo club. Take her to well, there's Bruce Bernard and the Rough Richards, and the girls from way down Trackety. How many nosers and herring jokers just don't know exactly. Now you've been on the side to dance all night, get the old barn floor just a rocking. Ring ding do, the P.I.S. who, take her to the gumbo club, and we'll do a little gumbo clogging, do a little gumbo clogging. The freaky day to pull track for those good roses. Yeah! I'm a Susie Jack, but tonight we're back with the huge and guns and lobsters. Oh, see, town, we're gonna tear you down. I got me money coming out of me stocking. Oh, you know what I knew? The bushwhack zoo. We'll take it to the gumbo club, and we'll do a little gumbo club. And we'll do a little gumbo club. We got the fishing brew, and the quahog stew, and a bowl of clam chowder. Just see me reach for that newbie's grace, when they hit it up the fiddle jig louder. And the French girls singing, the guitars ring, the squeeze box squeaking, squawking. And me and my suit gonna whoop-dee-doo, and take it to the gumbo club. And we'll do a little gumbo club. We'll do a little gumbo club. And we'll take it to the gumbo club. And we'll do a little gumbo club. And we'll do a little gumbo club. And we'll do a little gumbo club.
All right, wasn't that something else? J.P. Cormier and Dave Gunning. Wow, wow, wow. Woo. We got this party cooking now, don't we? You want to believe it. This next lady, and I mean lady, that we're going to bring up here, became a really, really close friend of Tom's, and we had lots of pleasures doing some very interesting events and social affairs for this particular lady when she was the Governor General of Canada. I want you to please welcome the Right Honorable Adrienne Clarkson, ladies and gentlemen.
Well, you know, Stompin Tom loved me. I'm so happy to be following Dave and JP. We first met at the East Coast Music Awards 10, 12 years ago, and I've been following them ever since. And we shared that passion for Stompin Tom Connors. And we love him, and to come after them is the only time I will ever do a gig after them. Stompin Tom, the man that we're celebrating today, is that very unusual thing. Something that we can all agree about as Canadians. In this past week, since we learned that he had left us, we've been remembering him and thinking about him because we all agree about him. He was truly wonderful. He was a gift to us as Canadians. And I think the secret of his gift was that he knew that he was giving it. Perhaps one can think of it as a bit ironic that a man who was born with nothing, born into nothing, should in the end have given us all so much. He gave us, first and foremost, a real sense of ourselves. And he knew that whether we had grown up in Vancouver or Red Lake or Happy Valley Goose Bay, we knew what he meant when he said, the girls are going to bingo, the boys are getting stinko, and nobody talks of inco on a Sudbury Saturday night. We knew what he was talking about then was the way that we had to live life and the way that we could escape from life. And he showed us that he understood it, and you could still laugh about it, and we could still make it rhyme. And you could do all of this in a verse that was turned to song in the purest kind of poetry, the most direct verbs that have no adverbs. His verbs just say it all. They don't need to be modified. And there were no pauses except for the emotion to come through. When Stompin Tom stomped on that board, he stomped Canada, Canada, into our hearts. But it wasn't just geography. And it wasn't just a sense that he knew how hard it was to work in the tobacco fields of Tillsonburg, or that he had seen Saskatchewan on who knows how many freight trains and reached Newfoundland on coal boats. Those were details. But beyond the details was the life and the soul that gave that life to us. Because all of Tom's life and work were a gift. And you know, the nature of a gift is that it is not asked for. We didn't ask for Stompin Tom. He just blew onto us like a wonderful wind. Like Bud the Spud, rolling down the road smiling, he drenched us all in the roads and the valleys, the rivers, the railways that he had traveled. We were part of his journey, and he has become part of ours. A couple of days ago, I listened to a wonderful radio documentary by Philip Coulter of the CBC, which used a lot of Tom's interviews over the years, plus his music, and including a very early interview done in 1969, 43 years ago, when he was introduced by the interviewer as the promising young singer, Tom Connors, performing at the Horseshoe Tavern in Toronto. And when he was asked what he'd really like to do, he replied, and he'd just begun to get that gravel in his voice, but it wasn't there all yet. I want to sing about the things that I know and the things I feel about this country. Nothing of that ever changed. Whether he talked about the scoops, the fork, the horse, which bring out the Irish moss on PEI, or the 19 workers who died on the Burrard Bridge so that we all could get on the other side in our motor cars. We knew that he was speaking to us about something that was in our collective souls. He sang that the best game you can name is the good old hockey game. D.C., he then confirmed us in our national delirium. I heard yesterday from one of his friends that he was so excited and happy to hear that Hockey Night is broadcast in Punjabi. Because for Tom, and we all know this, we sense it, we don't have to be told it, Canada includes all of us. I was fortunate enough to know Tom through all my CBC years when he would appear from time to time side by side with me in a makeup room when we were doing something at the same time. And when he had his own show, and when he and the lovely Lena, as she was known to all of us at the CBC, would turn up and bring their conversation and their warmth and their strong sense of themselves as people into our lives. And you know, that world of performing, of television, when people, what people loosely call show business, often just slips right over you, because often depth is not what it's noted for. But the first time I ever met Tom and Lena, and ever after, I knew that they were real. While I was at Rideau Hall, it was just a delight to receive Tom on a number of occasions and just give him things. Honors, medals, lunch, dinner, ashtrays. When he came for the Governor General's Performing Arts Award, where he got the Lifetime Award, everybody was in a flurry because they knew that Tom smoked, at least, one of them said to me, 10 packs of cigarettes a day. And Rideau Hall is just another government building in the eyes of the bureaucrats, and smoking is not allowed in government buildings. But we found a way around that. And we found an ashtray on a stand, and we put it just outside a door to the garden, but on the inside. And at the magic moments, it appeared so that Tom wouldn't have to be turned out to the outside. And in 2002, when we were planning a special luncheon for the Queen on her official visit to celebrate her golden jubilee, we came up with the idea of inviting one person from each year from 1952 to 2002, all the years she'd been on the throne, who had made their mark in Canada that year. So we had 1986 for the Nobel Prize winner in chemistry, John Polanyi. We had the 1992 winner of the Booker Prize in literature, Michael Ondaatje. We had the 1976 Governor General's Literary Prize winner, Margaret Atwood. And we were determined that we would have Stompin Tom for 1 year. We couldn't have 50 years of Marvelous Canada without one of them being Stompin Tom's. So it turned out that Stompin Tom came to represent 1971. Why? Because that was the year, for 9 consecutive weeks, he filled the Horseshoe Tavern on Queen Street in Toronto. This was all carefully explained to Her Majesty. As was the fact that Stompin Tom never went anywhere without his hat. I've never seen him without his hat, Your Majesty. And had never been seen by anyone, as far as we knew, without his hat. This was accepted with great royal equanimity. And the show went on, and we have the pictures to prove it. He and I only had a chance to have a brief chat during that busy afternoon, but he was beaming. He told me how much he liked being with all these people who had done things. He smiled with a lovely, beatific self-confidence because he knew that he too had done things. That he, Stompin Tom, was one of them. Being in that group made him happy, and his happiness was contagious. Many people would say, how could somebody who began their life so far behind the eight ball be happy? We know that he was born to a teenage unwed mother, that he was taken into foster care when he was still a tiny child. But he had lived rough on the road with his mother before that, who couldn't take care of him. We know that he ran away from home when he was 13 and was on his own from then on, and he bought his first guitar for $3 when he was 14. That he characterized himself as a drifter who would always be on the roads of life. And that made him determined, as he said, to sing what life was like for those who have no home. That life, rather than making him embittered, indifferent, or cold, made him understanding, warm, and cherishing, so that he could sing that he would stand between the mighty and the frail, even though he had been shunned by family and begged for bread. There's a very simple reason why we all respond to Stompin Tom. He is the real thing. He is authentic. In my travels all over this country for 6 years, what I learned from meeting thousands and thousands of Canadians like you is that you can always detect what is real, all of you, what is true, what is honest, and you always will be able to if you're given that chance. Stompin Tom's songs give us that chance. Even people who grew up in great comfort with their parents' love and have always been loved and have never slept rough in a ditch or been thrown out of bars a little after closing time, recognized in Stompin Tom somebody who spoke for the suffering and the reality that lies behind so many people's lives. He made us feel that reality, and he made us understand, and he made us want to be part of it. He made us feel that we could be at our very best because he described the details of a life that we knew was true. And he empowered us to feel for other people, to understand what it's like to live sturdily and to live alone. He turned his suffering into generosity towards others and his loneliness into love for all of us. As I look out at you all here today who come because of Stompin Tom, because of what he stood for, because of what his music meant to you, I know why you're here. You're here because why I'm here. Because we all loved Stompin Tom Connors. He may not have been loved at the beginning, but he certainly was loved at the end. And he always, always will be loved. You know, friends make other friends, and you make a magic connection. And his worship, Daryl Bennett, mentioned Romeo Dallaire, a wonderful Canadian I hope many of you have been able to have some contact with through his book, Shake Hands with the Devil, through the documentary that was made of his years in Rwanda, and who was the force commander for the ill-fated United Nations peacekeeping force in Rwanda trying to stop a genocide. Knowing that I was coming and going to speak in person here, he gave me a letter which he wanted me to read, and I'm going to read it to you. It's his message Lieutenant General, the Honorable Romeo Dallaire, now Senator Dallaire. During the lowest time of the Rwandan crisis, we were rationing food, we had no ammunition, we'd run out of potable water, and the international community was not bringing us any reinforcement in the face of this civil war and mass slaughter. My headquarters was being bombarded directly by artillery fire in order to break the will of the small United Nations force left to witness the catastrophe. At the height of this crisis, in order to maintain morale as bombs were smashing around us, I found my tape of Stompin Tom songs, in particular his song about the Blue Berets. I played it under fire. The mood and the atmosphere shifted completely from fear to comfort and confidence. It was boisterous, foot stomping, hand clapping, and laughter permitting us to weather that bombardment and several others subsequently. The very human and down-to-earth expressions of joy and respect in Stompin' Tom's music and lyrics came through without reservation to all of us, who from one moment to the other were not sure of our fate in that war zone. And here is that clip.
Snipers began rifling the streets just seconds ago. There must be at least two dead and many more wounded. I can see a Blue Beret. He's crawling towards a wounded civilian woman. She's been shot. The snipers are only about 200 yards away from us, still shooting. Okay, he's got her. He's helping her now. The courage of these men and women is just amazing. This is Terry Foster reporting from the streets of Sarajevo.
Dragi sin.
I'm Captain Brian Koschel, and this is Stompin' Tom Connors' tribute to the courage and dedication of Canada's Blue Berets.
Yes, we are the Blue Berets. We're up and on our way with another UN flag to be unfurled. Till the factions are at bay and peace is on its way, we'll display our Blue Berets around the world. Yes, we are the Blue Berets, we're always proud to say, we'll stand between the mighty and the frail. And where children cannot play because war is in their way, we shall send our Blue Berets in without fail. For we are the Blue Berets, and though we're far away, tell our family and our friends who come to call. If you count the lonely days, you'll see your Blue Berets marching home again to say we love you all. Blue Berets, we're marching on our way, where the bullets fly and rockets madly hurl, and where hungers never cease and mothers cry for peace, we try to bring some hope to an ugly world. We are the Blue Berets, we're marching on our way, with another UN flag to be unfurled. Till the factions are at bay and peace is on its way, we'll display our Blue Berets around the world. For we are the Blue Berets, and though we're far away, tell our family and our friends who come to call. If you count the lonely days, you'll see your Blue Berets marching home again to say we love you all. If you count the lonely days, you'll see your Blue Berets marching home again to say we love you all.
Isn't that something? That's probably the first time a lot of you people have ever seen that video. And that was one of the first things Tom said. I'd love to have that video played at my celebration of life. So Tom, you got everybody. The Right Honorable Adrienne Clarkson. Wasn't she something else? All right, I'll tell you. I was there all those wonderful nights up there, I'll tell you. We had a wonderful time, and you certainly extended a warm welcome and made Tom and the family feel so relaxed. And I know three different occasions we were there, and as soon as he heard it was for you, not a question. We were there. It was wonderful. Thank you ever so much again. As I mentioned a little while ago, we know there's lots of representation here tonight from Prince Edward Island, and we're real happy to hear that so many people made the trip. Thank you very, very much. And this next lady that we've got coming up here happens to represent the federal government tonight. She's the Honorable Gail Shea, Minister of National Revenue and the Minister for Atlantic Canada Opportunity Agency. We've had many nights with Gail up at Tom's Place too. Come on up, Gail.
Thank you very much, Brian. I'm very humbled to be here today, along with my colleague, Peterborough MP, Dean Del Mastro, on behalf of Prime Minister Stephen Harper and the Government of Canada. And for all the friends and the fans who want to be here, on behalf of all Canadians everywhere, our heartfelt condolences go out to you, Lena, to Tom Jr., and to your entire family on the loss of your beloved husband, father, and grandfather. And I can tell you that Canada has lost a best friend. Yesterday, Mrs. Harper and I presented the Canadian flag that flew in the Peace Tower the day Tom died. We presented that to Lena and her family as a keepsake from all of you. I was raised, as Tom was, in beautiful Skinner's Pond, Prince Edward Island. And in a community of little more than 100 people, you can imagine the pride we felt when Stompin Tom said he was Stompin Tom from Skinner's Pond. Now I'm here to tell you a bit about my first meeting with Stompin Tom. My experience with Tom actually started on a bit of a sour note. And it was over a potential development on his property at Skinner's Pond. I was with the provincial government at the time, and the negotiations had broken down between Tom and the local development agency. There was a bit of finger pointing back and forth, both sides in the local newspapers. So I decided, it's time to speak to this man face to face. Let's get the issues on the table and get the negotiations back on track. So I was granted a 30-minute meeting with Tom if I showed up alone. Well, since I had to have my development officer there to discuss the details, I said to my office, okay, call them back and tell them that I said, no development officer, no meeting. So I had to put my marker down. Now, I certainly didn't get the impression that politicians were high on Tom's most trusted list, I can tell you that. And I'm not sure why that might be. So Tom's manager, Brian, picked us up at the airport, and on the way to Tom's house, he tried to prepare us for what might be a very disappointing outcome to our very short meeting. I think Brian was very concerned about how this might go. So we arrived and we met Tom and we instantly became friends. The half-hour meeting turned into an all-night meeting. We talked about Skinner's Pond, the people, we talked about politics, we talked about his songs, his life, his family, and he offered so much advice, free advice, he said. And during the course of the evening, he confessed to me that he was so nervous about having this meeting with me that he hadn't slept for 2 days. We laughed hilariously. But the image that will be with me forever is upon leaving his house, Tom was on the doorstep saying goodbye. Tears coming down his cheeks. This was Tom, a humble, upright Canadian who valued the simple things in life, which are always what mean the most to us as well. So while I'm honored to be here today representing the Government of Canada, I do want to acknowledge those families from Skinner's Pond, PEI, who couldn't be here, and some of them are here. Because they're feeling a tremendous loss as well. And I can tell you that even 99-year-old Esther Doyle gave an interview to the local media about Stompin' Tom. So I've penned a short poem in Tom's honor, which I'll call My Country, My Home. From the humblest of beginnings to a great poet of this land, we have learned many great life lessons from this extraordinary man. He sang of our great cities, and the smallest were part of his plan, of the rugged and natural beauty of his so deeply beloved land. He greatly respected our soldiers, and of pride in them he sang, for he knew the price that they have paid for the freedoms enjoyed in his land. He could walk with princes and paupers, and the same of both he would demand, be upright, caring, and honest, and trust the shake of a hand. He worked to help our musicians and artists went hand in hand, and encouraged them to sing their songs in their home and native land. His songs spoke to common people about things they love and understand, like ketchup, potatoes, and tobacco picking, and the struggles of the everyday man. His memory will live on forever through the messages in the songs that he sang, in his wife and sons and daughters, and through the millions of his fans. We will leave this evening's memorial on one thing: united we will stand. Canada is so much a better place because of Stompin' Tom, the legend, the man. Thank you.
Gail Shea, ladies and gentlemen. Wonderful, wonderful lady. Got a couple of things I'm going to read here before we bring our next guests up here. Got a couple of emails today that really touched me, especially this first one. I want to read you this one. It comes from a lady by the name of Leona Boyd. Guitarist and singer Leona Boyd is out of the country and regrets she can't be here. But she wanted me to read this tonight. I felt profound sadness hearing that Canada lost one of its most patriotic musical champions. Tom, thank you for launching my career back in the 70s when he established the first ever Canadian classical record label, Boot Records. Bless you, Tom, for being such a uniquely Canadian. We'll sure miss you in your stomping board, Leona Boyd. This next one comes from a gentleman by the name of Tommy Hunter, Canada's country gentleman. Every once in a while, an individual comes along who completely changes the preconceptions of what traditional music should be. Tom was a storyteller, but not in the traditional vein. He wrote and sang with pride songs about Canada and the people about Canada. Much of what he wrote about, he gained from personal experience. Tom was loved, admired, respected, and controversial. And he was not afraid to take a stand when it was counted. In other words, I feel he embodied the spirit in Canadian song. I'm going to miss that spirit forever. Tommy Hunter. Speaking of fine Canadian talent, we've got two of the sweetest voices that ever come out of Canada, and I know Tom loved them both very, very much, and they're here tonight, ladies and gentlemen, Sylvia Tyson and Miss Cindy Church.
And welcome back, J.B. Carvier, to sing along with us. The great Canadian poet from Prince Edward Island, Milton Acorn, mourning a lost friend, once wrote a poem called, "I'd rather have the man than write his epitaph." And I think that reflects everyone's mood tonight. But you know what? I think he's here. Tom Connors was a man of strong opinions with a unique way of expressing them. He didn't mince words. He was a people's poet, a voice for those who never found words to express themselves. He gave to us a true sense of who we were and where we come from. Whatever he wrote and sang, he'd been there and done that. This is a song that comes from Tom's maritime roots, a place where people have a long tradition of singing about their lives and their work. And I think that's why he loved this song.
The sun was setting in the west. The birds were singing in every tree. All nature seemed inclined for to rest, but still there was no rest for me.
Sing along.
Farewell to Nova Scotia, the sea-bound coast. Let your mountains dark and dreary be. For when I am far away on the briny ocean toss, will you ever heave a sigh or a wish for me? I grieve to leave my native land. I grieve to leave my home. And my aged parents, whom I always loved so dear, and the bonny, bonny lass that I do adore. Farewell to Nova Scotia, the sea-bound coast. Let your mountains dark and dreary be. For when I am far away on the briny ocean toss, will you ever leave a sigh or a wish for me? I have three brothers and they are at rest. Their arms are folded on their breast. But a poor simple sailor just like me must be tossed and driven on the blue sea. Farewell to Nova Scotia, the sea-bound coast. Let your mountains dark and dreary be. For when I am far away on the briny ocean tossed, will you ever heave a sigh or a wish for me? Farewell to Nova Scotia, the sea-bound coast. Let your mountains dark and dreary be. For when I am far away on the briny ocean tossed, will you ever heave a sigh or a wish for me? For when I am far away on the briny ocean tossed, will you ever heave a sigh or a wish for me?
Thank you.
It doesn't get much better than that, does it? Holy Lifton.
Thank you to the band.
Excellent. Very, very nice. While we're reading a few greetings here, there's another lady that wrote a note here today. Her name is Rita McNeil. It was certainly a great loss for Canadians to lose Stompin Tom Connors. My heart goes out to his family. His song, I Am the Wind, summed it all up for me. He has given to this beloved country a lasting legacy of songs, celebrating our places and our lives. Stompin Tom, you are the wind, and the mark you left will forever be so proud, and treasure these songs you write for your country, our country. You'll forever be missed and loved. Rest in peace. Love, Rita McNeil. Boy, oh boy, oh boy. Now this next gentleman that's gonna come up here, I could go on and talk all night about this man. He is the best industry person that's ever happened to the Canadian music industry. He's the man that not only passed my letters on to Stompin Tom when I wanted him to come out on tour, and I begged him, begged him, begged him to keep sending them up there. He was also the man that brought Stompin Tom back into the recording scene in 1989. Past president of EMI Records, ladies and gentlemen, an order member of the Order of Canada, Mr. Dean Cameron. Come on here, Dean.
Thank you, Brian. How about another stirring round of applause for these great artists and musicians? We've come here tonight to participate in this incredibly joyous and distinguished celebration of the remarkable life of Thomas Charles Connors, a man best known to us all as Stompin Tom. And while we pay tribute, we also say goodbye to our dear friend. But what an incredible send-off. However, I believe that every person in this room knows that his outstanding legacy will live on forever in the hearts and minds of all Canadians. And as such, for generations to come, he will never truly be gone. I've had the distinct honor of being Tom's friend and a friend of the Connors family. As well, for 25 years, I worked with Tom alongside the entire EMI Music Canada family in the partnership of marketing, promoting, and distributing his music to Canadians and to the world. Now, it wasn't easy in the beginning because I had to go and find him. And then it took me about 6 months to talk him into coming out of retirement and making music for Canadians again. And I'm glad he did. Tom's prominence in our EMI Canadian artist roster was the guiding inspiration to so many artists, and not only in our roster, but the many musicians from Canada. And it's not just Canadian artists that love Stompin Tom. Over the years, we have discovered so many artists, particularly Americans, people like Dave Grohl from the Foo Fighters. They're incredible fans of Stompin Tom. Working with Tom all those years has been one of the highlights of my personal life and those who were the EMI Music Canada family. His music will stand as a significant pillar within the Canadian music industry and the history of the industry forever. It's very difficult to know where to begin recounting the achievements of the very important life of Stompin Tom, but they've been well covered this evening so far. from his very humble beginnings, which he would tell me about when we would gather around the bar, to his rise as a great Canadian icon. He built a powerful career, glorifying his nation by singing real songs of real people from real Canadian places. And in a very sincere way and convincing way, because he almost convinced me a couple of times to hop on that bus and go see Canada again. From the hockey song to Bud the Spud, Canada Day up Canada Way, and all your other favorites in between, he forever stayed loyal to his roots. With his music and poetry, he made us laugh, he made us cry, and for certain, he always stirred in us that unique feeling of patriotic pride in a way that only he could. He has always made us comfortable with the status of being Canadian by showing us that Canadian truly means having our own unique identity, but not at the exclusion of other nations. I know that this was his dream to sing about Canada, and we all know it became his mission in life. And not once did I ever see him waver from this passionate commitment. What I will remember and cherish most from Tom's life was his enormous courage, his courage of conviction, and an uncanny ability to create magic, and you all know that, in his music. He had principles for living, and he certainly had rules about making his music his way, and he practiced those religiously. Stompin Tom, the patriot, a troubadour, a storyteller, and a poet laureate for the everyday Canadian. He loved his family and friends, and for sure, he was always enthusiastic about celebrating life. And we all joined in, did we not? And he loved that. Tom, for now we bid farewell, but we will always keep you alive in our hearts through the inexplicable magic in your music. Thanks for inspiring us, and thanks for leading the way. As the ancient saying goes, every man dies, but not every man really, really lives. But you did, Tom. Thank you. Thank you very much.
Dean Cameron, ladies and gentlemen, a wonderful man. Thank you very much, Dean. You know, we were going through a lot of old clips in town here, thanks to our friends at Cogeco Cable that sat up till 7, 8 o'clock in the morning with their editors pulling stuff together. And we found this clip from 25 years ago when Tom came back and did a private little show at the Matador Tavern in Toronto. And this next gentleman that's going to perform for you, it was with the Rio Statics for many years, Mr. Dave Bedini. But let the video tell you all about it. Let's have a look here.
So, why Stompin Tom Connors?
Why?
Why is he so cool?
Well, he's the most important man in Canada, I think. Has always been so, and very important to musicians as well. He set the example for young players of our time and players of other generations as well. And I went to Ireland in 1986 to go to school. So I came back and didn't really know too much about the mythology, but found out that no one had seen him in about 10 years. So I hung around Boot Records for about 2 weeks, wanting to find out where Tom was, because I just wanted to talk to him. And I wanted to tell him how important I thought he was to the musicians. So one day in December, I was friendly with the receptionist at Boot, and she held up a letter addressed to Richard Hatfield, inviting him to Stompin Tom's birthday party. So I wrote down the address of where the party was, and hugged her, gave her a big kiss, and borrowed my sister's car 2 weeks later, and my friends and I went up and greeted him at this old community hall north of Guelph and told him we were there to represent like young musicians of Canada. And he said, where'd you come from? We said Toronto. And he said, came all the way from Toronto, you might as well come in and have a few drinks. So that was 86, and now here he is, and we all feel wonderful.
Wow, so handsome. Me and a couple of friends crashed Tom's party, and we hadn't seen him for a few years, and Dean signed him to EMI, and Tom brought a couple of records. I wrote this story about going to Tom's party, but I didn't really know if Tom, you know, approved. I hadn't talked to him. I didn't know what he thought about it. And then Tom was to play at Massey Hall, and we got a call from the record company who said, that, you know, did we want to go to the show? And we thought that would be great. So they sent us a couple of tickets, and we went down to Massey Hall, and we walked into Massey Hall, and I remember we had really good seats. We had, like, second row right in front of the stage, so we thought, you know, it was going pretty good at that point. I remember I turned around and I saw Lena, and she gave us a big smile and a beautiful wave and kind of made us feel even better seeing Lena, the beautiful Lena. And Tom played a show, and then they had a reception afterwards at the top of the Senator. So we went there, but again, I was kind of unsure whether Tom kind of liked me or liked what we'd said about him. The evening kind of played out. They gave Tom a gold record. We were at the back of the bar. Tom was at the front. And before we left, myself and Tim Vesley thought we should probably just go say hello to Tom. But we weren't sure. So we went up there, and Tom had a way of looking at you, a very kind of hard way that, frankly, just fucking terrified you. Like, you look at you like you didn't know. This is on TV, so I'm going to swear a lot. So I walked up to Tom's table, and he looked at me, and he said to me, Bedini, you've had to take a lot of shit from me over the years. I didn't even know what that meant, but it didn't sound good. So I was a little terrified, but then, of course, got up from the table, came over, and he gave me a big hug. And, you know, heroes aren't supposed to do that kind of thing, but Tom was the kind of hero that did do that, that would reach out to you and take you close and make you feel that what you were doing was the right thing. So thanks for that, Tom. It was incredible. So the song that I would like to sing, Bridge Came Tumbling Down, I'd like to sing it because when we did our first tour in 1987, the first time we were ever in Vancouver, the first time we were anywhere outside of Toronto, and we went on tours, I'm sure so many of us have gone across the land because of Tom, because of the songs that he sang and the places that he sang about. I remember being on Granville Avenue, walking down Granville Avenue in the morning after we arrived and walking past a shelter and seeing two homeless men sing this song to each other. And when your music reaches that far into the consciousness of the people, you know that it's strong, powerful, special, singular, brave, courageous. Bridge Came Tumbling Down.
A one.
Well, 19 scarlet roses, the chaplain spread around in the waters of Burrard Inlet, in old Vancouver town. So the bridge came tumbling down, the bridge came tumbling down. 19 men were drowned in June of 1958 in old Vancouver town. There were 79 men working to build this brand new bridge. It spans the second narrows and connects up with the ridge till the big wind hit the bridge. The bridge came tumbling down, and 19 men were drowned, and the medical corps couldn't be too sure of the rest of the men they found. In among the twisted girders, one man realized how last night he'd been dreaming and saw before his eyes the big wind on the rise. The bridge came tumbling down, 19 men were drowned, and they saw the fright of the darkest night in old Vancouver town. Well, the frogman in the water
by the cutting torch's glow. They fought to save the steel man from certain death below, and the pain you'll never know. The bridge came tumbling down, 19 men were drowned, and the 60 more who came ashore, so thankful they were found. It often makes me wonder, in strength who has the edge, the tallest steel beam structure that spans the highest ridge, or the men who built the bridge. The bridge came tumbling down, and 19 men were drowned. The other men came back again to lay the new beam down. This is Al Whitmire on the Upside Down Guitar. Crossing this mighty bridge sublime, and 19 scarlet roses cast before your mind, remember and be kind. The bridge came tumbling down, and 19 men were drowned, so you could ride to the other side of old Vancouver Town. So you could ride to the other side of old.
Dave Bedini, ladies and gentlemen. Well, now it's my turn. Oh boy. As far back as I can remember, Stompin' Tom was a household name around our house. And by the time I was 8 years old, not only did I have my first Stompin' Tom record, I met the man on more than one occasion. I'd never been to a live show before, let alone an event with so many people. And for my 9th birthday, Stompin' Tom was performing at the Peterborough Exhibition. And that night changed my life forever. I became a really huge fan and stuck through and through because I adored and loved that man named Stompin' Tom. It's kind of a connection that's hard to understand, but for those of you around the Peterborough area, you'll probably remember a Sunshine Sean that used to do a radio show on Czech Radio here in the afternoons. Well, but every second day, I used to call him up and bug the daylights out on to play a Stompin' Tom song, and I managed to get about 3 a week, so I thought that wasn't too bad. And my constant communication ended up leading to a wonderful relationship and business that Sean and I had for 35 wonderful years, and I'll never forget that, and it's all thanks to Stompin' Tom. Tom's retirement from the music industry left a real void, especially with me. I continued to collect the records and enjoy them, but there was this real want inside me to see Stompin' Tom back. And by 1988, I had already had 10 years under my belt as a promoter, working along with Sean and doing different shows. And it's all going back to a guy I idolized back in the 70s. And I knew it was a long shot that I'd ever get a chance to promote any of the shows, but a few letters here and there. And on the particular occasion, Tom was performing at the Matador Tavern in Toronto, where they showed that clip from Dave Bedini. And the record company called the office because they knew I looked after Wilf Carter. And the guy was named Jody from EMI at the time, and he said, "We're having this wonderful party at the Matador in Toronto for Stompin' Tom." And before he could go any further, I said, "Put me down for 2, I wouldn't miss it for all the tea in China." And the guy was so embarrassed on the other end of the phone, he couldn't say no at this point. And I said, "Yes, and I'll pass the invite along to Wilf." And we had a chance to meet again that night, and I passed along a letter that I wrote to Tom, and I was sure enough to put a CD of Wilf Carter's in there just to seal up the meeting. And through our mutual friend, Dean Cameron, who kept passing these letters on that I was sending through to Tom, I ended up getting a meeting with Tom in his house in late 1988. I was so nervous going up to that place, I'll tell you, I didn't sleep for 3 days. We sat down and visited, and we talked and talked and talked all night long. I had every single Tylenol they ever had in the house. I had every one of them. He said, you remind me of a guy that gets a lot of headaches. I said, well, I don't usually, so why don't we call you Headache Edwards? So I said, I'll be fine. But anyway, we talked and talked and talked to the wee hours of the morning. And by the time we were done at 5:30 in the morning when I left that house, we'd shook hands and decided to go across Canada for 6 months and do 70 shows. And I tell you, I was so shocked when I left that house, I didn't know what the heck to do. But I learned something about Tom from there that I never knew before, and I still haven't quite got this down pat, as somebody will tell you that has ever worked for me or toured with me. I never could figure out why it would take 6 months to do 70 shows. So I called him up and I said, I think we got something wrong here. He said, well, what do you mean? I said, well, we can do that, knock that off in, I don't know, 2.5 months. He said, well, not with me or not. He said, we're going to work 3 days 1 week and 2 days the next. I thought, God, that's only 2.5 days in a week. How the heck are we going to make that work? So Tom got the map out and he was explaining it to me, that when you drive every lick of the country yourself, driving 200 miles a day, that's no day off, Edwards. I want a day off once a week when I get out of that bed. I want to look out that window, see my truck, and know I don't have to go anywhere. So I'll tell you, that's exactly what we did. Anyway, 24 years later, 310 shows coast to coast, and thousands and thousands and thousands of memories that go through your mind. Adrienne Clarkson referred to some wonderful trips at her residence when we were gathering up there for some great events. And the one with the Queen struck me the most, because writing that letter to Adrienne Clarkson's office and saying, now look, we got this hat on here, and we gotta have the hat. I got this lovely letter back and said, well, that's no problem. The Buckingham Palace has no problem with it whatsoever. They're gonna consider it the same they would consider a religious headdress. So I got thinking, that hat does remind me of a religious headdress. And for those of you that have sat up till 5:30 in the morning, sooner or later that subject's gonna come up. But anyway, I always had a great fun talking to Tom and talking to him about his religious headdress, and we always had a lot of fun with that. We're running a little bit behind, so I want to share a couple more stories. I don't want to steal the thunder from anybody, because I've certainly talked to everybody across the nation. I think we've done 185 interviews in the last 4 days from coast to coast, and it's just, I'm telling you, the love of this man across the country, being there. We made a deal. I never always was on the road every day, but I made a deal I'd never miss a show. So oftentimes I flew from Vancouver back to Toronto, drove to Peterborough, and flew back out to Victoria 3 days later, because I still haven't got this 2.5 day thing down part yet. I can't get that straight, not even to this day. But anyway, a couple more funny stories. A gentleman by the name of Farley Mowat that lives up here in Port Hope. Remember that fella? We all had to read that book, Never Cry Wolf, whether we wanted to or whether we didn't. We're at the Literary Awards in Montreal one time, and that in itself was a challenge, going to there to do this in the Delta Hotel, when Tom liked a hotel that you could drive up to the door. The heck with this high-rise stuff. So we're in the Delta Hotel, and I'm underneath this thing, and I'm saying, oh, the roof of your truck, no problem, Tom. That roof, no problem. He got about a run in the first corner, and we heard this great big scrape, and we're trying to back this car out, or this truck of his out in Montreal. Anyway, Farley Mowat comes up to us at this party, and he gets on his hands and knees, and he starts to kiss Tom's boots. And Tom says, what in the hell is that? And this is Farley Mowat, and Tom says, my God, what the hell is it? So gracefully, Tom shook his hand, and they shared some pleasantries, and we had a wonderful visit. Tom and Farley both received the Literary Awards that night. But the funny part about it was, Farley hadn't had enough. So he thought he'd come back again. This time he had the award in his hands. So Tom thought, I'll fix you. So he says, will you sign my award for me, Stompin' Tom? He said, Fartley, I'd do anything for you. You give it to me. So he gave it to him, and Tom threw her on the floor and stomped a hole, and he said, how do you like that? And that was something else. Over the years, Tom and I had a special diet that we enjoyed. We would become quite fond of a dish that I've liked all my life, and I wasn't sure who kind of shared that, but no matter whether anybody shared it or not, we had it on every tour. And the last particular one I remember was my birthday out in Mission, BC. And Tom says, Tommy, you go get the pot. Edwards is here, and it's his birthday. 5 boxes of Kraft dinner we got ready. And 2 buckets of Kentucky Fried Chicken. A bottle of Crown Royal and some Moosehead. It was wonderful. It was something else. You know, Tom was a true businessman, and entertaining for that fans meant everything to him like you wouldn't imagine. We might have had 2.5 days on the road, but this man on those 2.5 days gave 200% every day. It wasn't 100, it was 200%. I've seen him stand up on that stage and drip and sweat and stand there, never once ever grab that towel or anything, and he's saying, these people paid hard money to see me. This arena could be 300 degrees. I'm going to keep going regardless. And we did an arena one time over in Gravenhurst, Ontario, and I'll bet you it was 200 degrees in there. And J.P. Cormier had almost had a heart attack that night. Anyway, one of the things that Tom wanted everybody to do on the road, we always had our great times out there, our games of croquet and our games of anything he wanted to play, we played it. When it came to showtime, he expected everybody to at least give 150 if he was given 200. So we always tried to do that. He made sure that when we had show days, it was business from the time he walked out of bed long after the night was over. And I never, ever, ever forgot that. Very, very much so. One more quick little thing. I also learned never play Scrabble with Stompin' Tom because he'll nail you. I was always a sitting duck. I could never spell, and I still can't spell. And he always loved to write me these letters back saying, Edwards, what in the hell does that mean? There's not even a word. Anyway, he'd pull these long words out that would scare you. And sure enough, you'd look in the dictionary, and he'd have one worth about 49 points there without any doubles or triples or anything else. And it would be real. And I don't know how he ever got those letters, but ladies and gentlemen, it's been a true honor to be part of this entire process. I can't tell you how much I've loved it. We've been going on very little sleep for the past couple of weeks, and the way I look at it is this. Tom always went till at least 5 or 6 o'clock in the morning, 7 days a week. He lived on very little sleep. Sometimes on the road, he'd get no sleep. But he was here, and he did it. So the least we can do, if it took us another 5.5 months, we'd have done her too, because we'd love him to death. We got some special family pictures that were shared with us over the past few days and some wonderful video clips that we spent a lot of time with our friends here at TVCogeco to put together. I want you to watch these monitors and share some wonderful memories. There's some great clips in there that we've had and special family pictures of Christmas at home and all that sort of stuff. Ladies and gentlemen, enjoy.
Here's to it and at it and to it. And if you don't get at it when you get to it, you'll never get to it to get at it again.
People running in the race, buying up the bargains in the old marketplace. Another sale on something, we'll buy it while it's hot and save a lot of money spending.
As most people know, I've spent most of my life right out on the road, never really spending any length of time in any one place. But through it all, I've always considered this spot, right here, as my home. This is Skinner's Pond, Prince Edward Island.
There was a time with a buddy of mine when a freight train was our abode, and we found people in this here.
Well, I don't consider myself to have a very good voice, and I'm not a good songwriter, and I'm not a good guitar player or nothing else. But I'd like to go to every known place in the world and sing to the people my songs about Canada. Because then they'll know that Canadians are the very same kind of people that they are.
Hey, are you Stompin Tom?
Frank Mahovlich.
You are Stompin Tom. Come on, sing us a song then.
I just happen to be writing a new one.
We're heading for Ontario, and we're off to make her big. Cause Margot's got the cargo by, and Reggie's got the rig.
I tried to peddle my songs every place I went, and I'll call you, you know, don't call me. And knocked on a hell of a lot of doors, and it just wasn't there. I wasn't writing commercial stuff.
Of all the places you've played in Canada, are there any places where you haven't been received well?
That I haven't been received well? Until recently, I've never been received well. They may never come back, but the issues are the issues.
There's an awful lot of people who come from my kind of meager beginnings, and I think that it's inspiring to them when they see somebody of my ilk getting something like this.
And there's a lesson in this somewhere for me, for you, and for anybody that comes to Sudbury and takes a long look at this big nickel. The lesson seems to be that all the little nickels in the world, if you had them and piled them all up in one big pile, they're really not half as important as seeing the people of this town when they come together, especially on a Sudbury Saturday night.
It so happens that I'm a Canadian. And it so happens that I'm very proud to be one.
That if you don't believe your country should come before yourself, you can better serve your country while living somewhere else.
Live or die, no matter what, I'm gonna sing songs about my country, and I especially like to incorporate the humor or the sadness, whatever it may be, from the people that I met, and transfer that to the people that I'm about to meet. So, put it all together, and what do you get?
There's a time when I like to stand out on the Cape alone. It expands your awareness. It makes you want to cry and makes you want to laugh at the same time. You're so happy, like, in a way that the God of the universe is so vast and has created you. And you seem to be crying at the same time with a kind of humbleness, a humility, a thankfulness.
When they come up to me and ask me for an autograph or show me a record that they bought or a picture they took, what enters my mind at the time is that I feel humble.
Thanks for bringing that in.
Because I don't want them to look up to me, because I feel uncomfortable about being in that position, because I know that if I had a chance to sit down and talk to that person, each and every one of them, directly, to say to them that it's because of you that makes me who I am. It's nothing that I've done. It is you. So it is me that should look up to you rather than you looking up to me. It's about the only way I can really explain it.
You hear every day how they're going away. I guess they just don't understand. The singer is the voice of the people, and his song is the soul of our land.
So singer, please stay and don't go away, with so many words to be said. For a land without song can't stand very long when the voice of its people is dead. Oh, singer, you must search for your place on the earth, while the same for your nation is true. So lift up the soul of your country, and a place will be found here for you. But don't go and run till your song has been sung and the words of your soul have been said. For a land without song can't stand very long when the voice of its people is dead.
You might say, because I never had a family, that may be one of the reasons why all Canadians became my family, an extended family.
You may pile up your gold, but the pride of your soul is the small bit of hope you bestow on the children who come this way tomorrow in search of the right way to go. So singers, sing on like the first ray of dawn with your promise of day just ahead. For the land without song can't stand very long when the voice of its people is dead. Oh, I hear every day how they're going away. I guess they just don't understand. The singer is the voice of the people, and his song is the soul of our land. So singer, please stay and don't go away. So many words to be said. For a land without song can't stand very long when the voice of its people is dead. When the voice of its people is dead. And the voice of its people is dead. And the voice of its people is dead. And the voice of...
Nobody ever called me Stompin' Tom until Peterborough, when a waiter down in Peterborough sort of hung the moniker on me and got up on the stage one night and said, "Ladies and gentlemen, here he is, Stompin' Tom, chews more plywood than all the beavers in Canada and does this and does that." And so that's where it started.
I was born in old St. John, New Brunswick by the sea. Back in 1936, it was just my mom and me. And as she wandered through the land, shunned by family, she often had to beg for bread while I was only three. She taught me to hitchhike and to face the road alone and sing about what life was like for those that had no home. Holy, holy, holy. Well, I turned four in Halifax, five in Montreal, in every small town in between, by six I knew them all. And when the long road took us back to St. John, Mama cried. That night the strong arm of the law tore me from her side. And they made me an orphan and taught me not to roam, just cry myself to sleep at night and not be a rolling stone. Holy, holy, holy. By the time that I turned eight, they said that I was cured, cured from all that wanderlust to which I had been lured. And just in case my mum would try to find out where I'd gone, they shipped me off to PEI to a farm in Skinner's Pond. And though I love the country, I call this island home. I'd sing about what life was like with a mother's love unknown. Believe, believe, believe. When I was 13 years of age, I couldn't take no more. I ran away from home one day and left my island shore. And while the Mounties everywhere were looking for their men,
On a merchant ship from old St. John, I sailed for Newfoundland. And away out on the Grand Banks, the truth came like a knife. A drifter I would always be upon the roads of life. Before the age of 17, I seen this country wide. An old guitar I'd gladly play, and I'd thank you for the ride. And many a conversation's had through my journey long. They wound up in my repertoire of Canadian country songs. And everywhere I traveled, I dreamed along the way, God might make this vagabond a country star someday. Then one night in Timmins Town, North Ontario, they said, if you can sing, we'll keep you around for a week or so. I packed the place for 14 months, and before they let me go, I'm driving a car, I got a new guitar, and I'm singing on the radio. From there, this old hitchhiker, he was on his road to fame, with Bud the Spud from the Bright Red Mud and the good old hockey game. Oodly, oodly, oodly. Then came Sudbury Saturday night at the Gumboot Clogaroo. They made me the chairman of the board till I stomped the hole right through. And like old Luke with his old guitar, my song wasn't over yet, till I sang the ode that I wrote for the road and the mum that I can't forget. And when the party was over, I began to write this song. And tonight you've heard me sing the words to the ballad of Stompin' Tom. Tonight you've heard me sing the words to the ballad of Stompin' Tom. Oodly, oodly.
The largest country in the world and yet the least sung about. I mean, I would say, come on, songwriters, get out there and start writing, because there's millions of stuff, millions of things you have to write about.
Something else. We're going to continue on with some wonderful music. This lady comes all the way from up in Labrador. Newfoundland, and Tom loved her singing, and Davin Doyle's here, ladies and gentlemen. Let's bring her out here, sweetheart. Come on out.
I want to start this off by saying that I've already received two calls from lady friends, including Kim Stockwood, saying how beautiful you look, Leapin' Lena. You just look gorgeous on the TV, apparently, here in person and on TV tonight. Round of applause for Lena, everybody. Beautiful. So Tom was a unifying force that defined what it means to be Canadian. From Newfoundland to British Columbia. I'm from Newfoundland, or as he'd like to say, Newfoundland. From Newfoundland to British Columbia. Anywhere I travel in the world, people, when I tell them I'm Canadian, his name inevitably will come up, and including Rwanda, where he is bigger than Rihanna. I am not joking. You go to Kigali and they're like, Stompin' Tom Connors. It's good times. So it's such an honor to be here. Love to you all. I'm gonna do the Coal Boat song, because I've always loved it. And let's do some gender bending and mix this. I was about to swear, but I think Tom would like that. And I need a beer. It feels weird not to do this with beer. I had one over there. I'll pay you $5 right by my coat. There's a beer. All right, let's do this. Well, I left Cape Breton on a coal boat for St. John's, Newfoundland. And I met a little girl named Sally, and I took her by the little white hand. She shook her little head and said, no way, Fred, I won't go on with your plan.
You've been working on the cobalt boy, and you're nothing but a dirty old man. You've been working on the cobalt boy, nothing but a dirty old man. Well, I had to think of something real fast. Well, I'm gonna quit the dirty cobalt. I wanna live in Newfoundland. I'll buy a suit, get married, put a ring upon your little old hand. Shook her head and said, okay, Fred. So I went along with the plan. But I'm still working on the cobalt boy, and I'm nothing but a dirty old man. I'm still working on the cobalt boy, and I'm nothing but a dirty old man. Well, sometime later on the cobalt, I got a little letter from home. Sally said Freddie was a good boy, but the little bugger wanted to roam. She said that it's too bad, she's got you for a dad. I hope you feel real grand. He's gone working on the cobalt boy, and just like his dirty old man. He's gone working on the cobalt boy, and be just like his dirty old man. Well, I left Cape Breton on a cobalt to St. John's, Newfoundland. Good old Sally was waiting, and I took her by the little white hand. Shook her head and said, no way, Fred, I won't go along with your plan. You ain't gonna quit that cold boy, cause I loves you, you dirty old man. You ain't gonna quit the cobalt boy, cause I loves you, you dirty old man. So come on, young fellas on a cold boat, I hope you understand. If you got a pretty little girlfriend and you take her by the little white hand, if she turns her back and says, no way, Jack, I won't go along with your plan. Just keep working on the cold boat, boy, if you want to be a dirty old man. Just keep working on the cold boat, boy, you'll be nothing but a dirty old man. Just keep working on the cobalt boy, and you've been nothing but a dirty old man.
Dabna Doyle, ladies and gentlemen, wasn't she great? Holy boy. That was something else. Tom would have loved that, let me tell you. See the smile on all those boys' faces up there? So did they. You know, Tom's love was for hockey, and everybody knows that. And his favorite hockey team, regardless what anybody ever said, was the Montreal Canadiens. You want to believe it. And we've got a gentleman here tonight that was not only the best goalie that Montreal ever had, he was the best goalie that Team Canada ever had, too. Remember that? You want to believe it. He's a wonderful friend of Tom's, and I can't tell you how excited we are to have him here tonight. Ladies and gentlemen, Mr. Ken Dryden.
Thank you, Brian. It is an honor to be part of the celebration of Tom's life. Tom could do two things I always wanted to, but couldn't: sing and wear a cowboy hat. I first met Tom in a hockey rink. It was after a concert in Huntsville, Ontario. There's nothing glamorous about singing in a hockey rink in Huntsville. Nothing glamorous about a makeshift stage on a cement floor. Nothing glamorous about winding down after in a hockey dressing room. Wooden benches, metal hooks, two fours all around. In a room that months after the season still smelled like a hockey bag. Like 20 hockey bags. But Tom was there because his fans were there. Because Canada was there. He sang from inside himself, from something inside himself that had come from St. John and Skinner's Pond, from Sudbury, Tillsonburg, and Huntsville, from good times and bad times, and everywhere in between. And if you sing from something real, you sing to something real in all of us. And that is what Tom did. He didn't use many notes. He didn't use many words. Just the right number, just the right ones. All of them connected by the grit and granite of his voice. All of them connected by his proud, defiant, unconquerable Canadian spirit. I love the hockey song. When I was with the Leafs during games, there was one stoppage of play that was reserved. It was the long commercial break in the middle of the third period. On a bad night, the song was a brief respite. On a night that might go either way, it was a jolt of energy. But on a good night, when everything was cooking, it was fantastic. Oh, the good old hockey game is the best game you can name. And for the 19,000 people and all the players who were there, who could deny it? And the best game you can name is the good old hockey game. And everybody, all of the fans, all of the players sang. It was a celebration of a team, of a game, of us. Mesdames et messieurs, ladies and gentlemen, please rise for our hymne national du hockey, for our national hockey anthem.
Tonight, tension grows, the whistle blows, and the puck goes down the ice. The goalie jumps, and the players bump, and the fans all go insane. Someone roars, Bobby scores at the good old hockey game. Oh, the good old hockey game is the best game you can name. And the best game you can name is the good old hockey game.
Hockey is our national pastime. Hockey is Canada.
Second period, where players dash with skates of flash, the home team trails behind, but they grab-
grab the puck and go bursting up, and they're down across the line. They storm the crease like bumblebees. They travel like a burning flame. We see them slide the puck inside. It's a 1-1 hockey game. Oh, the good old hockey game is the best game you can name. And the best game you can name is the good old hockey game. Third period. Oh, take me where the hockey players face off down the rink. And the Stanley Cup is all filled up for the champs who win the drink. Now the final flick of a hockey stick and a one gigantic scream. The puck is in, the home team wins the good old hockey game. Oh, the good old hockey game is the best game you can name. And the best game you can name is the good old hockey game.
That video opened up every national hockey game this past Saturday night, and thanks to CBC for letting us use that. We love it. It's wonderful. And thanks, Ken Dryden. It couldn't have been said any better. Absolutely wonderful. You know, we got one more note we want to read here from a gentleman that Tom thought also was carrying a wonderful Canadian torch across the country. And I've had four emails from him the last 2 days. He's so upset that he can't be here tonight. His name is Corb Lund from Western Canada. And Tom thought the world of him. He wrote a note today, and it said, I've always admired Tom's individuality and determination to cut his own swatch from start to finish. I'm a big fan of his music. He was always a big musical influence, but more importantly, he was a big inspiration to me, far trusting my own instincts. This is a big loss, and I feel along with the rest of the country. I'm sorry I couldn't attend. It would be a real honor. Yours truly, Corb Lund. So we appreciate that very, very much. Speaking of great talent, this past week, I received an email from the East Coast Music Awards, and it said, you've got to hear this song. This gentleman has just written this song a few days ago. And I passed it on to Lena and Tommy and the family, and they called me up, and they were just ecstatic about it. I said, can you get this guy to be here? And I said, well, I'll bet you I can. The name of the song is called So Long, Stompin' Tom. Mike Plume, welcome to the stage.
Thank you very much. So long, Stompin' Tom, I can't believe you're gone. So long, Stompin' Tom, but at least we've got your song. Like Bud the Spud from the bright red mud and the gumboot cloggeroo. So long, Stompin' Tom, may God take care of you. Me and my wife and kids, we all sing along. Driving around Moncton Town, singing a hockey song. We were tooting at it, and we was at it, and to it, until we tuned our attitudes in. So long, Stompin' Tom, until we meet again. Well, so long, Stompin' Tom, I can't believe you're gone. So long, Stompin' Tom, but at least we've got your songs. Like Margot's got the cargo by and the old muckluck shoe. So long, Stompin' Tom, may God take care of you. So many people I've met, but yet I don't know their names. Like poor old Ben down in the pen and that gal Red River Jane. Or potato and tomato riding the Windsor in their car. And looky, they're walking past the old pawn shop.
if it ain't Luke with his guitar. Well, so long, Stompin' Tom, I can't believe you're gone. So long, Stompin' Tom, but at least we've got your songs. Like the TTC skit editor and Goodbye Rubberhead too. So long, Stompin' Tom, may God take care of you. Well, the Father, Son, and the Holy Ghost, they're all hanging on every word. As you're singing songs about Saskatchewan and tobacco from Tilsonburg, and all them pretty angels, they're all singing with you tonight. And when you see my mom down in the front row, could you tell her I'm doing all right? And so long, Stompin' Tom, well, I can't believe you're gone. So long, Stompin' Tom, but at least we've got your songs. Like Big Joe Mufferaw and a Sudbury Saturday night. So long, Stompin' Tom, may you rest in peace tonight. Hey, so long, Stompin' Tom, may you rest in peace tonight.
Mike Plume, ladies and gentlemen, wasn't that something else? Boy, oh boy, oh boy, wasn't it? We're almost left with nothing else to say. But what we do have to say, there's a very special video clip here that we want everybody to watch. And a lot of people have probably have never seen this, and if they have, it's been many, many, many years. We pulled this off a VHS copy of the Stompin' Tom series that he recorded back in the 70s. He did a number of different shows across Canada. And this particular one was done at a church that was, it's very, very touching, and I hope you really, really enjoy it. Ladies and gentlemen, please watch your screens for Tom's version of Our Father. I'm so glad we were able to find that, and I understand a few weeks ago when they were going through some stuff, Tom really enjoyed that version and wanted to make sure that was played here tonight. We've got something that's going to happen here that is amazing. On behalf of the Connors family tonight, I want you to please welcome to the stage a young man that looks exactly like his father. Ladies and gentlemen, Tom Connors Jr.
I have no notes, so I'm just gonna fly by the seat of my pants, as the old man would say. So on behalf of him, I'd like to thank everyone here for coming tonight. It means a lot. He's here with us. We're giving him the best send-off we possibly can because he did everything he could for us to make us feel better to be Canadian. As I look down in the first row or two here, I see a lot of family, and I'll tell you all, you may think being the family of Stompin Tom is cherries and roses, but it's not. This would be, I would have to admit, the first time all these people in one room have been together. As you know, being an entertainer over the years, it's a life that can take you down many roads, and he has a big family. They're all here. It's the first time the four kids of us have been together upon this celebration. I have a brother, Ta, a sister, Carol, a sister, Karma. It's the first time we've all been together, believe it or not. So Tom had a way of bringing people together, whether he's here in person or in spirit. And he was a very spiritual man. He wanted to write a third book about his spiritual side, but he never did get that chance. So just to give you a moment to understand the inside of him, the Tom Connors, I just want to let you know that he was not a believer in anything. He wanted and strived to be a knower in everything. Research, learning, reading, everything he could, speaking to every individual he could along the way, learning about Canada, learning about himself, learning about all of you, and he put it into song. And along those roads, he had a lot of time to think within himself who he really was. And he spent every minute of the day trying to find the answers to the universal questions of life deep within himself. I'm not going to tell you that answer. It's for every one of you to do the same. Look within all of your hearts and your soul and find out who you all really are. Because Tom did that, and that's how it came so naturally to him, to sing to all of you and rise you all up as a people in this country. There's always a silver lining and some sad news as well. This year would have been Tom and Lena's 40th wedding anniversary. Just because he's passed doesn't mean they're still together. And on your 40th, I think we'll have a big party because the old man will be there with us. And sometimes within death must come life. And Mom and Dad found out not long ago, a few months ago, that together they're going to have their first grandchild with my lovely girlfriend, Jessica Roselle. And these fellas back here, it's strange the order that they're in. It wasn't planned, I don't think, at least I didn't. But as you can see, it's not always easy to be with Stompin Tom, because when you start, everything's great. But you can see, they start with nice dark hair. And that fella in the end has been with Tom since the 70s. So it's not always easy being around Stompin Tom. Now, the old man told me to drink a few beers tonight, so I can't keep going too much longer because I've got to go to the washroom. But I'll just leave you with something. He traveled coast to coast, seeing all of you. There would be no Stompin Tom without all of you. And all of you watching tonight on TV, you are the reason why he was there and did what he did and will be with us forever. I heard some people comment the other day at the funeral saying, "Oh, there'll never be another Stompin Tom." Well, I got news for you. We still have a Canada, and we still have the same roads, towns, peoples, jobs. And that's what Tom wrote about. So never say never. If you see a man or a woman hitchhiking down the road one day, maybe without any money, maybe give them a ride, because you never know. They may have just wrote the next song about Canada. And we may all love that person just like we did the old man. So keep your eye open. You never know. He never liked anyone copying him. But anyone that wants to sing about Canada, keep her on going, all right? It's nice to travel south. It might be warmer on the skin, but if you go east and west, it'll be warmer on your hearts.
Now, how do you follow that? My God, he was fabulous. Thanks very much, Tom Jr. We've chatted earlier this afternoon, and he said, "I'll give it a shot." And did he ever? It was absolutely wonderful. You want to believe it? Absolutely fabulous. One of Tom's favorite songs is a song he wrote a few years back called "I Am the Wind." And one of the favorite singers that sang that song was a guy named Mark LaForme, and Mark opened up a lot of tours for us across the country. And Tom has asked that Mark do this song here tonight. Ladies and gentlemen, Mr. Mark LaForme.
Thank you very much. And thank you, Tom, for all you've given us. I am the wind. I am the wind. Without foe, without friend, I have no home, no cares to tend, all alone, I am the wind, I am the wind. A gentle breeze in lover's glen, in the awesome tales of fishermen testing sails. I am the wind. Trees at summer's end, but I'm the song of spring again, right or wrong. I am the wind. Around the door, between gods and men,
I've got one promise to Tom and one promise only. Edwards, if you leave them on a down note, I'm going to come back and kick your arse. So, anybody's been to a Stompin Tom concert or any time around, you always know that you can always come back. And we always had this particular song, and we got the whole cast coming out. Ladies and gentlemen, Sudbury Saturday Night.
Are out to bingle and the boys are getting stinko. Well, ain't no more a winkle on a Sudbury Saturday night. The glasses they will tinkle and her eyes begin to twinkle. Well, ain't no more a winkle on a Sudbury Saturday night. There's Irish Jim O'Connell there and Scotty Jack McDonald. There's Honky Frederick Herschel Gildenside. Well, that's all right. There's happy German Fritzy there with Frenchie getting tipsy. And even Joe the Gypsy knows it's Saturday night. When Marianne and Mabel come to join us at the table and tell us how the bingo went tonight, we'll look a freak. But if we win the money, we'll be lapping up the honey. For everything is funny, for she's Saturday night. Yeah, the girls are out to bingle and the boys are getting stinko. With ain't no more of ankle on a Sudbury Saturday night. The glasses, they will tinkle and her eyes begin to twinkle. With ain't no more of ankle on a Sudbury Saturday night.
Mark!
The loot we borrowed and recuperate tomorrow. Cause everything is wonderful tonight. We had a good fight. We ate that deli pickle and forgot about the nickel. And everybody's tickled for a Saturday night. The songs that we'll be singing might be wrong, but they'll be ringing when all the lights of town are shining bright. And we're all tight. We'll get to work on Monday, but tomorrow's only Sunday. We're out to have a fun day, for she's Saturday night. Yeah, the girls are out to bingle, and the boys are getting stinko. With ain't no more of ankle on a Sudbury Saturday night. The glasses, they will tinkle, and her eyes begin to twinkle. With ain't no more of ankle on a Sudbury Saturday night. Sudbury Saturday night. The glasses, they will tinkle and her eyes begin to twinkle. We'll think no more of ankle on a Sudbury Saturday night. We'll think no more of ankle on a Sudbury Saturday night.
Thank you very much, ladies and gentlemen. Have a safe drive home. God bless you all. Thank you.
Man over 60, they raided his place.
They took him by force and they sprayed him with mace. And if you never heard such a thing in your life, why, they even came back and arrested his wife. She had called the reporters and they're on the phone. They could hear the commotion outside of her home. They broke down her door and they dragged her away. Then they hung up the phone and said, have a nice day. Now everything's quiet in this neighborhood. With Bach and Beethoven, their music is good. They're oiling their mowers and washing machines. 'Cause if they get noisy, them Mounties get mean. And if you have a neighbor that's bothering you by playing that stomper, then here's what to do. Just call the police and create an uproar, and you won't have to hear Stompin' Tom anymore. Just call up the Mounties and they will make sure you won't have to hear Stompin' Tom anymore.